first, I'd like to start talking about food. I want to know, I would like to discuss the specifically food intolerances first, and why there seems to be such a commonality in our culture of having, like, specifically gluten and dairy intolerances, and where that has come from and why it has become such a big thing.
Much of the food intolerances, as you say, are an example of law of attraction, are an example of a collective consciousness momentum. Not long ago, most of you did not know what gluten was, and today it is the culprit. Mm-hmm. Previously it was fat, and then it was carbs. Mm-hmm. Yet you continue in this cycle of labeling a food bad and continue with the same health issues for some weight issues, regardless of what the current bad thing is. Our guidance toward food is to be much easier about it, to trust your instincts. We tell David, if food comes in a box, it's probably not as good as something that grows in the ground, but there are those that eat food from a box and live to be 100 years of age, completely healthy. So much of it, and David struggles with this, is the attitude. He still very much believes that carbs are very bad, and he'll give up carbs, but he still doesn't lose the weight that he wants to lose because of this weird belief system that's going on there around food. So much of it is just relaxing, doing what feels right, not allowing the momentum of others to impact you so much. If you eat something and it makes you feel bad, you should not eat it again. But there is no right or wrong food for everyone. Those that choose not to consume animals are often very, very adamant that no one should consume animals. And it's coming from a place really of lackful thinking and not understanding that the animals understand that they come and go very easily, and that the process of killing the animal can be very disturbing. But you also have to kill a plant to eat the plant, and it's all life. So unless you're going to start eating rocks, which have energy as well, you're always going to be eating something that was life. So our advice is always, if for you, you do not think it is right to eat an animal, or to eat gluten, or to eat carbs, or to eat fat, then you can follow that. But are you following your own in the stream instincts and what makes you feel good physically? Your bodies tell you very quickly what is good and what is not. But like many things, you tend to tune that out. So when you eat something and you feel good after you eat it, you are in a good space. If you eat something and your body reacts negatively to it, don't eat that again. And it really is as simple as that.
So does it come down to our thoughts about the food that we're eating, and then how the body's reacting to that?
Both. Your bodies have developed over time tolerances and intolerances for the things that you eat. Mm-hmm. And that all started with your line of thought. But as we always say, anything that you are far down the path with, mm-hmm. if you have developed a physical intolerance to something that probably did start as a mental intolerance, but is well developed, it's going to take some time to work your way out of that if you indeed desire to work your way out of that. Okay. Because it's you're far down the path, there's momentum built there.
Right. So I guess a process with that would to start changing my thoughts around the food that I'm eating. Like, if let's use the example of gluten and dairy again. If I crave bread, but then I'm thinking, oh, it's really bad and my face is going to break out or something, when I eat it, how do I close the gap?
Exactly the process that we gave earlier. Think of the other places where you've closed the gap, and can you bring yourself, and the answer is always yes, but can you bring yourself to believe that you can eat that nice big piece of bread and not have an adverse reaction to it. So that's for you to answer. You can do it, but you have to be able to bring yourself to that. And again, anything that's developed, anything where you are far down the path, it's going to take some work. You have to back out of it. That's why we like the spiral, because you're always having to spiral backward out of something, back out of something, especially if you believed it for a long, long time. You've got to reverse that spiral and back your way out of it in time. Okay. You can back your way out a lot quicker than you got there, but you're not going to do it just like that.
Okay. And what about, I want to know about like doing detoxes for the body, like bowel detox or liver flush, you know, kind of practices. Are those good for the body? Is that helpful in clearing certain ailments or things that are going on with the body?
There are certainly things that your body absorbs that are more pleasing to it than others. Mm-hmm. And taking a break from the less pleasing things will make you feel better. Mm-hmm. And that's really what detox is. David did Kundalini yoga. And even for David, thought it was weird. And joked and said, I channel for a living and I'm in here thinking this is weird. And it was a very odd, because he's accustomed to doing regular yoga and going to the gym and doing all of that. But this was a lot of breathing exercises, and two, three days later, he felt absolutely amazing. And so yesterday he went back, and somebody else was new that was there, and he told them it was the weirdest thing I ever did, and it was the best I've ever felt. And it was a detox, and it was just breathing, just movement and heavy breathing. And we were connected with them as fully as we are now through that whole process. So that was a very good detox for him. So replacing things that your body does not agree with things that it does agree with, that is your definition of detox.
Okay. And there are certain foods that are more nourishing to the body than others. I guess you did kind of mention that earlier, like preservative-free, for example.
Well, your desires and your manifestations as brilliant human beings jump ahead of your bodies, of your evolution. That is why a 15-year-old girl could still become pregnant easier than a 30-year-old woman. Because there was a time where it was completely acceptable for a 15-year-old girl to start having children. Well, your desires, your lives have become so much more complicated that does not work in your current society, yet your body is not yet caught up to that. The same thing stands true to your food. You have all of this food that in the evolution of humanity is very new, packaged, processed food that your bodies will catch up to. But you have not all caught up to that yet. That is why somebody can eat what one may consider garbage for a lifetime and live and be very healthy and die of what you would consider an old age, while many others struggle with that. Your bodies have not and will never catch up with your manifestations. That is a very good example of the law of attraction and your ability to manifest right there. The fact that you can create all of these things that your bodies take generations to catch up to, that you create so much quicker than we do. Nature.
Okay. And it's possible for the body to like regenerate as well. Like if I want to regrow certain teeth, that's possible for the body to do if I believe it strong enough.
We always say that anything is possible. Mm-hmm. And we often add that anything within your current evolutionary cycle is possible. So growing a tooth back is absolutely possible, just as jumping off a building and flying on your own is possible.
Okay.
there are things that you absolutely can heal that have never occurred before that you can do within your evolutionary cycle. But you have to bring yourselves to believe it, and your bodies are not going to morph into a totally different form in a lifetime. So there is a reality there that, you know, if you desire to grow a third arm, you're not going to be able to do that, but you can repair tissue, you can repair bones. You know, there are things that your body does do. You know, your body repairs its own broken bones simply by setting it. So that reparative quality that you possess, you've only begun to tap into. So there are absolutely things that you can do within your evolutionary cycle that most are not doing at this point because of beliefs. Okay. The placebo effect is very real.
Right. Okay. Well, now I'm going to move on to Kundalini Yoga, which is interesting. You brought that up just a few minutes ago. It's a practice that I've done off and on as well, and I've been curious about the practices on where, like, what's giving it its power. Is it, because I know there's a lot of science behind Kundalini Yoga with a certain breathing technique and the mantras and the mudras. You know, how much of it is the science, or is there, does it all come down to the belief and the intention that you're putting into the practice that gives it its power? Kind of where, is there kind of both?
The vast majority of that is the belief and the intention that you're putting into it. For David, he very much liked the ceremony of it, the way the instructor was dressed, the gong. He walked in thinking, this is very cool, and this is something different, and he likes different, obviously. So the intention was there, and that's why his first experience was so amazing, because he believed it was going to be something really special because of all of that. But all of those things are tools. Mantras, anything that you speak is a human creation. We don't speak. That's why we're sitting here using this body to speak to you. We are energy. We do not have a language. We don't need a language. So when you are chanting a mantra, you are chanting words that someone else came up with. But that's okay, because you have given power to your words. We could say things to each of you right now that would upset you very much. And that's okay, that's how you communicate in this world. So these mantras, as long as you embrace them and believe them, they will do the job for you that you are looking for them to do. But they are your creations.
Okay. So really, I feel like everything just kind of comes down to belief.
Everything comes down to belief.
Okay.
Everything has the power that you give to it.
Right.
So people, tools, or people idols, mantras, prayer, religion, all of those things, all of these things have the power that you give them.
Okay.
And everything in your life comes down to your belief, because everything in your life is your perspective. You are all living different versions of what's happening right now based on your perspective. One of you may be skeptical, one of you may be completely embracing of this, one of you may be thinking, you know, gosh, this is the most amazing thing that ever happened. You're all going to have that experience based on your perspective, which is rooted in your belief.
Okay. So then I want to talk a bit about the how to become stronger in a belief. I guess it's again closing the gap. And like, I find that I've been working with affirmations lately, and I'll repeat these affirmations, and even if I have doubt, or something, I'll often feel doubt in the moment when I'm saying the affirmation, but I try to repeat it to kind of close that gap to get to that point where I do start believing it. Is that a good practice to do in addition to, like, meditations and...
when you are repeating a mantra and you're saying one thing and feeling another,
mm-hmm.
you are hammering a square peg into a round hole. You know that.
Yeah.
So our guidance is to back away from the topic and ease your way into believing it rather than trying to chant or repeat a mantra thinking that it's going to tune you to a place that you need to tune here first. So you will all find yourselves in that type of scenario, and ease off, back off, and allow, because when you were chanting, I think I can, and your mind is saying, no you can't, you're down the spiral. And if you back off and relax, you'll find yourself back to neutrality, and then suddenly, within minutes, you can, I will, it's done. You know, you will find yourself being able to spiral back up. So don't try to hammer it in.
Okay.
It doesn't work for you. It just makes you uncomfortable.
Okay, so as a daily practice, in order to just raise my vibration as consistently as I can, we do daily meditations or, try to do positive thinking. I guess I wanted more, a little more clarity on the daily practices to do.
The most important thing is that you are doing something to raise your vibration on a daily basis. That's the most important thing. And we use the term find your meditation, because you're all different. And for one of you, it could be having a cup of tea, looking over a body of water. For another, it could be petting your dog, playing with your children, possibly watching television to relax and disconnect and not be in the negative mode where you're blocking our signal out. Anything that allows that signal to come through, you can take that and allow that momentum to build from there. And it just depends on your personality. Some people like rituals, like doing the same thing day after day, and it's automatic at that point. If you can go do that ritual, and you know that if you're gonna go sit outside and do yoga, you know, outdoors or something like that, and that's gonna bring you there every day, then just make sure that you're doing it every day. And it's just like, it's like a medication. Don't think because your life has gotten so much better that you can then stop or back off, because your life has gotten so much better because you are practicing that every day. But you do need to practice daily alignment. And this goes back to what we were speaking of earlier. When you had much simpler lives, when you're living in the caves and not working, and you know, had all this time to yourselves to think and to contemplate, you were in this state naturally. That's how all of this came to be, because you all had time to think about that. And that's why we always talk about, you know, careful what you ask for in your manifestations, because now you've manifested these lives with all these devices and these structures and all of these things, yet your lives are so much more complex that you don't have the time that you used to have naturally to just sit and think and connect. You've got to make time for that to happen now, right? So it will always be this way. Your lives will just continue to become more and more complex, and there will be more and more availability of distractions. Pick up a device out of your pocket and there's an endless amount of distraction there, and most of it is negative. Most of it is telling you something that's intended to draw you in, to scare you, and to use fear for you to read an article or buy a product or pay attention to someone. So it's up to you to cut all of that out long enough to stay connected, and then return to your humanness. And as David says, watch The Real Housewives if you want to, or whatever human thing you want to do is okay, but have the balance that you aren't spending all of your day staring at a screen, absorbing somebody else's thoughts, that you are in your own thoughts enough to where you keep your vibration where you want it. And you know what your vibration is, how you feel good. And if you feel lethargic, if you don't feel well, then you're not up there. And you need to get yourself up there. It's very important that you do that. If you're here caring about this, it's very important that you do that.
Okay.
More?
Yeah.